I think we provide a very valuable service in the state that no other group has done. CRES has established a unique niche.
I think CRES's role in the implementation of changing public policy has been tremendous.
When you compare Colorado to the rest of the country in terms of the amount of energy efficiency and renewable energy legislation that is there on the books, we are in the top tier.
The town fathers down in Lamar and the ranchers who have the wind turbines were absolutely thrilled to have something besides prisons and pigs that they could go forward on as an economy.
Renewables are a wonderful way to provide jobs, and that has happened in Colorado.
I'm very happy to see that CRES has grown into a robust organization, and they're making an impact, and they're changing Colorado's view of sustainable energy.
Back in 1973, 1974, we had an energy crisis, and it raised the awareness of the general public.
And there was a lot of sort of counterculture questioning of whether or not the so-called establishment is going to really deliver us what we need long term.
There was a group formed in 1976 here in Denver called the Colorado Solar Energy Association. Although this was started before the Solar Energy Research Institute got established, after it was, most of the people who were active in the Colorado Solar Energy Association were associated with CERI.
Previous to CRES, there had been a Denver Solar Energy Society, but was totally moribund in 1995-96. So I was challenged by a good friend to do something and thought that starting a chapter of ACES would make sense.
Ron and I traded names of people that we thought could be the nucleus. And we said we'd have a strategic meeting to put things together. And we had about 50 people there. And we at that time decided what the name would be and what our motive would be and how often we'd meet and what we'd do.
I think everybody wanted to join and to help and make a difference. It seemed like every one of our monthly meetings, the number of participants who came would grow.
That monthly meeting model of inviting an outside speaker, an expert, has just worked stellarly for CRES over the years.
The researchers from NREL are often there. Educators from the university are there. People from business.
People come to us because they want to figure out how to be part of the industry, be part of the movement.
It's a great way to meet the whole spectrum of people involved in renewable energy. The most important accomplishment of CRES is just as providing a means for people to talk to each other on a regular basis.
The first major event that we did was the solar tour.
Everyone lives in a house. Everyone works in a building, so they can relate to those environments. And when you can talk to them about things like that, they're really interested.
Our homeowners are, a lot of times, our most enthusiastic CRES volunteers.
We have homeowners that want to be on the tour every year so they can say, oh, I tweaked this thing and I made it 0.025% more efficient than it was last year, and you have to see it. We do active technologies, passive technologies, high-tech technologies, and very simple fixes.
CRES and probably most state chapters have done a pretty good job of emphasizing energy efficiency.
And it was an opportunity for us to show people this basic message: before you make it renewable, make it efficient.
The tour has educated thousands of people over that 15-year period. And what is a great joy is to see people who come to the tour every year, use what they've learned, apply it to their house, and then tell their neighbors what they need to do to save money, save energy, and to be much more responsible to the planet.
We decided we ought to have a conference.
The driving force for that was Dr. Doug Balcom, one of the most famous solar scientists in the country.
We've had a really prestigious group of speakers and presenters at our events.
To me, when you see that spark, you know, of an aha moment going off in an audience's eyes, to me that's the best way to teach.
The first ones we had were up at the YMCA of the Rockies by Granby. We would all show up in jeans and flannel shirts and have lectures in various rooms around the YMCA.
I remember one thing, we had a big campfire out in the back in the evening, And we all sat around the campfire and even sang songs. As the conference got more and more popular, and of course we really outgrew the YMCA camp.
Taking the show on the road made CRES more of a statewide organization. And because of that, we had two regional groups form, the Northern Colorado Renewable Energy Society and the Southeast Colorado Renewable Energy Society. So CRES has provided workshops around the state and at our conferences and tour and events.
One of the big victories was in 2001, when through CRES's advocacy at the Public Utilities Commission, that included people such as Ron Larson, Ron Lehrer, Steve Andrews, they put the evidence on the record that turned, that made the case that wind power was, at that time, when gas was pretty high, the least expensive electric resource.
So Xcel was forced to put in, was it 161 megawatts in Lamar? And we won a big victory.
And with that, people like myself who were trying to work these policies through the legislature were able to point out, hey, this works, and in this case, it's the lowest cost.
Three successive sessions of the legislature, we had bills introduced and a lot of support on a bipartisan basis for the notion that a minimum amount of the utility's power should come from renewable energy.
Primarily progressives and people who were representative of agricultural constituencies. And those included, on one hand, a fairly conservative Speaker of the House of Representatives, Lola Spradley, and a very progressive representative from the Boulder area, Mark Udall.
For 2 years, we won in the Assembly, and then we would always lose by one vote in the Senate.
The dynamic in the legislature was that the Republicans weren't going to do anything that the utility didn't want them to do.
That's what triggered the decision, mainly on the part of Environment Colorado and other organizations, to say,
take this to the ballot. At the time we started this drive, I think there were about 14 or 15 states that had varying degrees of renewable energy standards. This was the first time that proponents had asked the electorate in the form of a ballot initiative to decide on their own whether they wanted to have a renewable energy standard.
The leaders were people like Matt Baker at Environment Colorado.
One of our most important coalition partners was the Colorado Renewable Energy Society, which at the time of the initiative, Dave Bowden was the president of CRES and was very, very active on the campaign. But CRES also brought a lot of technical expertise, as well as was the grassroots group that provided the single most amount of volunteer signatures.
The story of Amendment 37, I think, is best explained by understanding the role of the utilities in fighting this.
The question is, what motivated that utility opposition? I think it was mainly control. You have this responsibility to keep the lights on. You're in control of that. You've been in control of that for 100 years. You're used to being in control of that. So when somebody comes in from the outside with an idea about changing that, your first reaction is, no, we can't change it because the lights will go out. Or in the case of the renewable energy standard, it'll cost more.
If there was a secret weapon on Amendment 37, that was Rick Gilliam. Rick Gilliam worked for Public Service Electric Company for 10 years, worked for Western Resource Advocates, and was the prime drafter of Amendment 37. So he knew where the bodies were buried, he knew how the electric system worked, he knew how regulation worked, he knew how to write legislation.
As more and more industry money, utility money was put into, I think, unfairly talk about the legislation, It became necessary for some of the groups to even borrow money to pass this.
It was not an easy campaign because we had opposition from the electric utilities who outspent us considerably.
Now the big utilities are running misleading ads.
While we started out polling around 63-64% once the ballot was finalized, the fact that the utilities, led at that time by Xcel Energy, which was the largest contributor to the No campaign, and other interests were able to outspend us in terms of television commercials, they were able to drive our numbers down considerably, but only by combating the distortions that the other side was throwing at us by getting on the air with television commercials, were we able to win. Before Amendment 37, renewable energy was kind of a novelty in Colorado. After Amendment 37, it became mom and apple pie. And in the next campaign for governor in 2006, in fact, Bill Ritter went on to run on something he called the new energy economy.
And he very quickly understood that the public is interested in innovation and is interested in investment for the future.
There was I don't know how to describe it in any other terms except a blizzard of new energy legislation that took us much further, I think, than any one of us would have imagined at the time.
He was able to sign 57 bills that related to energy efficiency and renewable energy into law.
House Bill 1281 doubles that to 20% by 2020.
We would then increase it again by 50% a couple years after that.
In the year 2020, nearly one-third of all electricity sold from our investor-owned utilities will be from renewable energy sources.
Now, we're at a very high platform because we have the 30% renewable energy standard. We passed the Clean Air, Clean Jobs Act. These are very substantive changes to the energy mix, the electric power mix in Colorado.
We found out that if you have these policies in place, that the largest wind turbine manufacturer in the world brings their plants to your state. And when you talk to the workers there, you find people who are, you know, they're transplants from other industries that have come in, and they'll tell you things like the guy told me. He said, you know, I didn't have any sense of purpose when I worked for the trucking company, but when I came here, he said, I think I'm doing something good for my neighbors and my family and my state, and I feel good every day doing that.
One big change that's happened with the hiring of our executive director is that we are now doing much more outreach.
One of his bright ideas, and came about because of his connections, was working with the Denver Housing Authority. And they were talking to him and said, we'd like to make a sustainability park.
Where we're going to be putting together demonstration projects for renewable energy, for energy efficiency, for urban farming and sustainable energy.
We're doing it because we see the future. We have a vision of it.
We really need to move toward carbon-free energy sources. There aren't a lot of choices there.
The fact that there is now support publicly in a way that there never was before, 15 years ago, shows that CRES has legs.
We've done, I think, quite well in establishing a positive attitude. We've got many wonderful corporate members. We're helpful to the industry. So we've done a pretty good job, but we've got a long way to go.
The folks in CRES need to give themselves a big pat on the back for the work that they've done. I think the challenge now is to implement the renewable portfolio standard, promote demand-side management policies that save consumers monies, and then three, modernize the grid and make it smarter.
What gets me most excited is that in the past, some of these ideas and dreams and visions were maybe abstract.
A lot of people have a general idea that this is the right thing to do and it's a good thing, might be good for them. But if CRES can help them make it real so that they take steps in their own lives to implement it, that's a real important role for CRES.
You begin to see these projects going forward. These are projects that communities, individuals can touch. And it's real. And it's based upon the hard work that our organization, CRES, has done.
I'm just absolutely delighted. I this is what Ron and I hoped for when we started. We didn't know it would work, but it has. And it's been a delight to both of us, I'll tell you that.